Wisconsin. This is the place that our case is taking place in today. Now, if you don't know much about Wisconsin, it's a hearty little Midwest state that we all know, don't you know, enough. And the Wisconsin people are so nice. They're like, yeah, that's really true. Y'all got cheese. Y'all got the Packers. It's a pretty cool place. Now, for such a wholesome state, this crime was pretty fucking gruesome. Let's talk about it. Okay, as I said before, we're talking about Wisconsin, specifically Medford, Wisconsin. Now, Medford, Wisconsin is in the middle of the state, and it is home to roughly 4,500 people, so pretty dang small. It has a lot of fishing and hunting, there's some golfing, it's rural, but you can enjoy the great outdoors there. There looks like there's a lot of campgrounds, there's lakes, and trailheads. There's trailheads, and per their website, bird and wildlife watching. So that's always cool. Now, a little town like this, everybody knows everything, right? So this case is one of those fun ones that happens in small towns. And yeah, here's everything that happened with it. It's kind of a rough one, but sit back, grab your favorite drink. I'm drinking Diet Dr. Pepper in a Yeti mug with lots of ice, because that's how I roll. And let's jump into it. All right, the first person we're going to talk about today is Tammy Armstrong. Now, it is said that Tammy Armstrong was born in the middle of Wisconsin, so it's pretty close to Medford, is our understanding. And she was born in 1978. When people described her in one of the documentaries I watched, they said that she was from a lower class family and had lower education. Her whole life was really centered around her family. And she became a teen mom. Now, not like a 16-year-old teen mom, but she had her daughter at 19, and then she had another son at 21. Now, sadly, neither one of these relationships panned out for her, so she found herself a single mom struggling to make ends meet. She loved her kids dearly, it appeared, and was trying everything she could do for them. So, yeah, that is the slight background we have on Tammy. All right, the next person we're talking about is going to be the victim, and his name is John Maier. Now, he's about 10 years older than Tammy. He also grew up in Wisconsin, and he was very mechanically inclined. So he was really good at taking care of cars, specifically diesels, and he worked for a shop for quite a while and became so good, he eventually split off and made his own repair shop that specifically focused on diesels and trailers, big trucks that we see for transporting food and stuff. That was his background. Now, it was said that he was really wanting to settle down. Like, he's got his whole business going for him, right? He's feeling like he's establishing himself. And he meets Tammy. Now, this isn't a huge town, so everybody kind of knows everybody. It was a big deal for Tammy, too, because she was a single mother. They made it sound like she was much less of a catch in the dating pool and had a hard time being with guys who desired an already semi-established family. But John actually really liked this and was all on board with it. And everything seemed to be going smoothly. So he's this good-looking guy who owns his own business, right? So eventually Tammy and her two kids move in with him. And not only that, they eventually buy a plot of land outside of town and put a double wide out there and start living out there. So they moved in together in 2000. And it seemed like the first couple of years, everything was actually going pretty good. Like, there was lots of laughs. The kids really liked John. It seemed like happy times from what friends and family recounted. And Tammy was a homemaker. Like, she was living that homemaker life. She didn't have to work or anything. Because John was so successful with his business, she was able to stay home, take care of the kids and not really have to worry so much. So at this point in their lives, for at least a couple years, things were looking up and all was good in the world. Fast forward to spring 2002. Now, like I said before, Tammy has lived with John and her kids with him in this double wide trailer for a couple years, and things had seemed to be going good, but at this point, it's not going as well. This is when the event happens. And what I mean by that is John just straight disappears. So he had a work study program kid from the local high school there working with him. And he told the high school kid that was working there, I'm just going to run out, do a few errands, but I'll be back within a couple of hours. Now, the weird thing here is Tammy calls in a few hours and and talks to the high school kid and said, you know, John's not going to be back. He's just too busy today. He had to come home. So go ahead, close up shop for him and he'll see you another day. So the kid was like, okay, that's weird because I'm a high schooler and I have no business closing up this place. But he went ahead and did it. The weird thing here is that day, that high school kid was the last who had heard from John. That was the last known communication with him. Eventually, like his coworkers, like the people that did work for him and his friends, and especially his mother who spoke to him every day, started getting suspicious. And they contacted Tammy and she said she didn't know where he was either. So suddenly everybody starts making missing posters and they even run an ad in the newspaper because everybody's so concerned. Now, the weird thing is it takes Tammy 3 days to file it. And her thing was like why she didn't call it in earlier. She had claimed there was an altercation between her and John. And John had threatened to kill her, per her words. And then he changed his mind and he stormed out of the house and left in a white Ford Ranger. And that was the last time she saw him. Thing though, is when cops question John's family and friends, they're like, he's never even had a truck like that. He has a red Ford F-150, not a white Ford Ranger. And they hadn't heard from him. And like I said before, the search started before Tammy ever even called the cops because John was such a reliable person that everybody knew something was wrong. They just knew. Okay, so not only is it weird that Tammy took her sweet time calling the cops to report John missing, she was also acting really fucking weird. She was seen in several local bars drinking with another man, partying up, not giving a shit. She was so carefree and certainly not acting like a woman who is missing her live-in boyfriend of 2 years. Everybody found it really strange and cops started taking note of this behavior because it wasn't normal. Now, something that Tammy didn't necessarily know about was that John was already talking to the cops. Now, the reason for this is he had found forged checks from his business that were bouncing all over town. And he had gone to the police to ask for advice because he knew it was Tammy. She was forging these for whatever reason. And he went and talked to them not that long before. The cops were already getting ready to talk to Tammy about something completely unrelated. And so she was already kind of on the radar. So this was an interesting development in the case that maybe Tammy didn't quite know about before. So with these two things in mind, the cops go and pay a visit to Tammy at that trailer that her and John had been living at for a couple of years, and she welcomed them in with open arms. She kept her story the same as when she first filed it. He had pointed a gun at her, changed his mind, and then stormed out with a gun. They thought she was acting very welcoming. However, they noticed some weird stuff. There was a rug cleaning machine in the hallway. Tammy claimed she had used it because her son had thrown up, so she had to clean it. Okay. Then there was a big reddish stain on the couch. And I go, Tammy, what is that? And she goes, oh, it's just a grape juice stain. Okay. So then the cop goes, do you mind if I have a look around? And she, oh yeah, totally. Go ahead and have a look around. The weird thing was they went into the laundry room and there was, you know, those big gallon ice cream buckets you can get if you have like, you guys probably had them growing up if you're as old as me, the big gallon ice cream things. There was water with what looked like blood in there. And then in the washing machine, there was tennis shoes, a sweater, a blanket, and some random clothes in there. And the fact that like the sneakers were in there, the cops are like, it was just such a weird combo to have in there. They're instantly suspicious. After the cops had a look around, they brought Tammy down to the police station just because of like these weird little things I just brought up. Got the carpet machine, we got the stain on the couch, we got the weird stuff in the laundry room. At this point, she said the same story. So she's keeping that going, the story, which we don't always see in cases like this, but she's keeping it going. They were able to, at least with the things that the cop had seen, they were able to issue a warrant, and they went in there with luminol. Now, what luminol does is if there is any traces of blood, it's going to light up, right? So they put the luminol in the living room near this grape juice stain. And the cops, quote unquote, quote said, it lit up the room so much they could see each other talk, meaning there was so much luminosity from the blood, the room was going strong. So the cops, there's no body, but they're thinking, we know where John was killed. Unfortunately, no body, no arrest. Now, with that search warrant, they continued to look for John's body. They did a very thorough investigation. They looked around the trailer they were living at the time, and they looked under a concrete slab, which was actually poured after John went missing. So they pulled that up, but there's no signs of it. So once again, they still cannot arrest Tammy. Their suspicions, like, high alert. She's the number one suspect, right? But Tammy continues to party. She goes to all the local bars with this guy that people say they think she was seeing even before John disappeared. And just, she was totally a murder suspect, but she was just out there living her life. It was pretty crazy. So at this point, the cops have Tammy go down for an investigation number two. Now, this is voluntary. She went down there on her own accord. She didn't resist. She was cooperating. But this time when she tells a story, the investigators don't believe her. And I'm going to have to put this clip in, but it made me laugh the way the investigator talks to her. So let me show that.
Told her I thought she was nothing but a lying bitch.
And after that, even Tammy wouldn't change her story. The cops, the two investigators that were working on this case, even admitted they were doing good cop, bad cop. So once the guy said that to her, the lying bitch, the good cop, stayed in there and started just trying to comfort her and made sure she felt good, befriending her, making her feel safe. So he didn't push her, he didn't threaten her or anything else. He just gave her his number and he let her go. The next weird thing Tammy did is she gave a news interview. Now, in this news interview, she didn't want anybody to see her face, but she allowed the interview. She never once mentioned that she was being treated as a murder suspect. Instead, she went on there and was pleading, you know, to John to please come back, and she misses him and loves him so much, and she's sitting there crying and, you know, oh, my babies always ask, where's daddy? You know, she's really trying to play up that she has no idea what's going on, and John, please just come home. You'll probably figure out why I'm sarcastic fairly quick here if you haven't already caught on why. So a couple days after the interview, Tammy reaches out to the good cop, as we had talked about, and his name is Larry Wobking. He says he can tell she's starting to feel guilty at this point and starts to show signs of being sorrowful. Like, she's starting to act a little sad and stuff. And she asks if she can revisit the house. Now, wanting to continuously earn her trust and make her feel comfortable, Larry allows her to do that. So they go there and he just kind of watches her go around the house. Now, nothing came of it that day, except Tammy eventually sat down after they went to the house and she goes, you never asked me where John liked to camp. And Larry, the good guy, goes, I didn't. Tell me where John liked to camp. She told him to look in Audi Lake, which is just right out there. And she goes, you guys should have a look in the water. So at this point, the good cop, Larry, sends out a whole investigation team because of this tip Tammy gave. Now, they send out the whole search team. They search deeply and completely and come up with nothing. So Tammy had given them a false lead. So after that false lead, Tammy gets arrested, but they can't arrest her for some murder because there's no body, right? So they bring her on them checks. They know, we said John was, this is what Tammy's doing. So they arrest her on check forgery. And part of the reason why they did this, they make her stay overnight. They want her to crack. Larry, the good cop, is noticing all this stuff. He can tell she's just weighing heavy on her mind. She's showing all the signs of getting ready to communicate. Tammy reaches out to Larry while she is being held, and Larry obliged, and she asked for her sister to be there. This leads us to Tammy going back into interrogation. All right, Tammy goes back into interrogation. And the thing was too, Larry was really good about that. He let Tammy's sister, Mindy, ask all the questions, and Mindy was quite good about it. And eventually Mindy goes, did you hurt him? Did you see the people that hurt him? And Tammy goes, I shot him. Finally, we get somewhere. Tammy claims she shot him in self-defense and that they were fighting over finances, and claimed John had brought out the gun and pointed it at her, but then put it down. So that, you know, that part of the story she kept going over, she still stuck with. But she said when he put it down, she instantly put it up and shot him because she was in fear for her life and her children's life. That is what she did. Now, at this point, Larry steps in and goes, Tammy, you need to tell us where the body is. You just admitted to this crime. Let's give everybody some peace and closure. Where is he? So she admits that she has put him in West Point Campground. If you guys go there, you're going to find him. Once again, whole search team, they go out there. This time they find a body.
Parts of the body.
They find a black trash bag and open it up. There are parts of a human in there. And they're able to test and tell it's Larry. Now they go, Tammy, where is the rest of John? And they were able to determine that parts of him were chopped up and burned in the campfire. So only part of John was found, but hey, it's a body. On to the medical examination. So we find two entrance wounds on the right side of his skull. The wounds didn't line up with any type of self-defense struggle. They're pretty clear, they're pretty clean, and the fact that they didn't go through the front of his head shows signs that this was more calculated than Tammy was saying. She didn't just pick it up and throw it back there. What they think happened is that she was standing at the end of the hallway where he was sitting on that couch where the grape stain, juice stain was, and shot it twice. Boom, boom. There's two entrance holes. Boom, boom. That is actually how John died, per the medical examiner. After this confession of Tammy and everything they found out, they're ready to go to court. Now, the prosecution is shooting for first-degree murder. Now, if she goes in there, she has a lot of stuff on her record now, right? So, first-degree murder, mutilating a corpse because she chopped up John, obstruction of justice for misleading and spending taxpayer dollars for a place she knew John's body wasn't, and for forging checks. They let her have a plea bargain. They said, if you take the second degree murder charge, you get a significant drop in charges. So there really wasn't much of a court case. Tammy snatched that deal right up and went and apologized to everybody, but still claimed it was self-defense. Now, that's kind of rare that we hear the plea bargain, or at least the cases I look at, but she is scheduled for release in 2033. She only got 30 years of prison for her second degree murder charge. And John's whole family was incredibly disappointed with this because she killed him in cold blood, right? 30 years. And I know people say women get way less harsh sentences, and I would say this particular case isn't helping anybody out. So my thoughts on this case, I feel like Tammy had a really good thing and she was messing it up. I mean, I feel like, especially if you go and watch any of the footage or anything with John, he seemed like a really just good guy. He was like, you know, dad, wholesome vibes. He seemed like a really good person. Now, you never know. You never really know somebody's relationship. Things always look different from the outside, but it feels like at a certain point, Tammy thought money meant more than people and ultimately took a person's life because she freaked out, but she was the one being the criminal and stealing from John in the first place. Like, the lack of personal accountability, and just, if you murder someone, I don't even know, that's the worst thing you can do. Like, she made her bed and she was going to be forced to lie in it. And then she shot the guy that she was already screwing over anyways, because the checks are bouncing. John was literally giving her everything he could, and it still wasn't enough.
So that's it, guys. I'm sorry, I forgot to say goodbye to everybody. So now, it's voiceover Andy. Hackety, y'all. I appreciate you so much watching my video, and if you like it, subscribe for more, and I'm going to pump out as much content as I can till I burn out or till I get a steady schedule. Bye!